I am Crystal. I've been here about 5 years. I started in the stroke unit itself, so I took care of at the bedside. So I was a bedside nurse. And stroke is something I'm very passionate about, just so you know. I think it's the brain is a phenomenal thing. And no. That's true. It's a little important. Just a bit important. You need to keep it. So I was at the bedside for about 4 years. I loved it. It was great. I happened to go back to school and get my master's. So, and then Candy Corral. Have you guys ever met Candy Corral? She was the prior stroke coordinator. She, I think, was the coordinator for about 3 years. She's now the director of the stroke program here at Huntington. She's fantastic. And is really championing some really fantastic things for the stroke and the new things that we're doing that I'm going to talk about a little later. So about last July, I applied for the position, and now I'm the stroke coordinator, and so I'm learning a lot of new things, and kind of it's very fascinating, kind of looking at the whole picture of what patients go through when you're in the emergency department, through, you know, the different units, and then what happens when you go home, and that whole kind of spectrum. And so that's what I'm learning, how to maintain and look at all that. So the question I get the most, and it's not just from the community, it's actually from other nurses and other people that work here at Huntington, is what do I do? That's great, I'm a stroke coordinator, but what do I coordinate? Because it just sounds funny. So one of the things that I'm going to sit a little bit. I threw out my back with my two-year-old son. No. The standing and leaning is better. You know, they always say lift with your legs, and I didn't do that, so I'm paying the price. You know, so what do I do? So half of my job is really looking at data and numbers, a little mundane, some standards and things like that. But one of the great things that I get to do is, I'm sure you guys have heard, you know, occasionally, have you ever been here and you hear a code stroke called, right? So you may or may not know what that means. Basically, someone in the emergency department is having a stroke, or they think it is, and to mobilize a massive team to go in there and to see, are they having a stroke? And because time is brain, as we all know, and so because the whole point is to get them diagnosed quickly so that if we can do something, we do it immediately. So I actually, when I'm here, I answer all of those. I go into the bedside and I really help facilitate all those people. To give you an example, any code stroke can have, you know, you have a patient and the nurse, but then you have 10 other people in this tiny room. And we're all competing to take care of every patient and to make sure that we get everything done in a timely fashion. If any of you have been experienced a code stroke yourself, you would know that there's just a lot of things happening in a very short amount of time. So I am kind of the spokesperson that kind of brings that whole group together and tries to keep everyone on the same page. As you can imagine, the more people you add to things, the more complicated it can be. But it's a fun process. I get to meet some fantastic patients and families, and I try to always touch base with families of the patients that come in, because what can happen with cold stroke sometimes is we're all in the room, and you know it's so fast that you know, I try to take the role to explain it to the family of what's going on, why it's so fast, and what's the need. Because from an outsider, it looks really scary when your family member is having those signs of a stroke, right? So it's something, it's a little bit effortless list of what I do. And as you guys know, you guys are familiar, I would assume, with the FDA medication, TPA, or Alteplase, that's the, you know, the key reason why we're looking at that whole fast is to get here, to get to a hospital, so that you're given that TPA within that time window, and it's such a short time window, right? And for years and years, that's all we had. And it's FDA approved for 3 hours, and that's all we could do. If you woke up with symptoms, and we couldn't establish when what we call last known well, there wasn't a ton we could do. But one of the reasons Wanda and I talked is that within the last 2 years, there has been some pretty fantastic changes in how we treat stroke patients. And what we're able to do now is, it's not just, TPA is not the only answer now. We have something extra that we can do to really help improve each patient's outcome, right? Because my goal is always, I always like to tell patients, we want to get you back to baseline prior to your stroke as much as we possibly can. And that's, every patient is different, right? Everyone has a little bit different deficits. Everyone has, everyone's brain is a little bit different in how the blood is supplied and where. So TPA, I think it came out, I couldn't remember. I think it's been 20 years, but I could be wrong. So up until 2 years ago, that's all we had. And then there started coming out a lot of trials. I know UCLA did one, and they were worldwide. They were looking at these special devices that basically, I always try to explain it like a Roto-Rooter. You basically go in through the groin, a patient's groin, you go to the brain, but it sounds, you know, they basically navigate their way up to the brain, and they're able to visualize that blockage and take it out. It sounds really simple, right? But it's pretty groundbreaking and fantastic. I like to explain it. It's very similar, you know, when someone's having a heart attack, right? We all know that that's that chest pain. They can go in and try to open that vessel, right, to save the heart. Similar type of concept. But prior to 2 years ago, there wasn't good enough equipment to really benefit patients. But once they started these trials with these new devices, they were having spectacular outcomes. I happen to be, and I'll pass around what this device looks like. So it seems quite intriguing. But what's really neat about this is that these patients are moving immediately right after this procedure. So if they were completely flaccid on one side, we're seeing patients right after this procedure start to move that arm. Whereas before we didn't have this available, or it wasn't. This is brand new. Yes. So yes. So during that time window, yes. Now, when we talk about, you know, the need to call 911, because TPA is about 3 hours, right? This procedure has a little bit wider time frame. We're able to do those patients now that wake up with symptoms that we don't know when they were well last. This one is about an 8-hour time window, sometimes a little bit more. It depends on where you have a blockage. So, you know, you go from a 3-hour window, which is a little tight, right? That, you know, if you wake up with symptoms, you don't know. But if you have a kind of an 8-hour window, I only sleep 6 hours because, you know, that's just how it goes. But this gives that extra tool to be able to do something and no longer having to sit and be like, you know, we're going to do everything we can to prevent another stroke, but this is actually giving another alternative treatment. Mm-hmm. Correct. Great question. The great thing about this procedure, so what happens, there, we have two specialists here at Huntington, we have two specialists, Dr. Ross and Dr. Constis. Yeah. And actually, Dr. Constis is doing this lecture right here at Senior Care Network. He's one of the, he's a neuroradiologist by trade. He's one of the ones that will speak on May 4th, and so he can better speak to this. But it's actually guided the entire time in a special suite that they can actually visualize the pathway of where they're going. So what we do is we do special tests before they even puncture to make sure is the route clear, or what way do they need to go? Do you go on the left? You know, do the left or the right? 20 to 15% that are a bleed, and that one is managed completely different, and that's hard, and that's why, you know, the important thing with when you have the symptoms, that's why we call the code stroke, is we need to know what type, because they're treated so differently. Because that brings in a different team, like, you know, that's neurosurgeons looking at you and what can we do. And sometimes it's, you know, they watch and wait and they're looking at what's going on. And the bottom line is we always want to know why. Why did you have a stroke, and why can we control all of those risk factors so that you cannot have another one, right? When I was at the bedside, my favorite thing to do with patients was to be like, okay, we're doing the top-down approach. You know, because you have so many people poking you and touching you, and you don't remember why they're doing the test that they're doing, right? You're like, I just know it's for me. You know, we basically want to look at your brain on down and say, okay, you had a stroke, whether it bleed or whether it be, you know, that clot type, and we want to know why. So is there something in your brain that we need to know about? Is there something in your arteries of your neck we need to know about? And then there's something in your heart. So I think that helps to kind of help everyone going, we got to look at the top down. At least that gives some security in knowing all this poking and prodding, so we prevent something down the road. So this, it's pretty incredible, this new procedure that we're able to do for patients. And we actually, last year, we started doing them in February, and I think we did over 50 cases. And again, like TPA, there is a set criteria a patient would have to meet, right? Because we want to make sure that we do it, it's safe and that it's, you know, it's appropriate. But they've had pretty fantastic outcomes. So it's just something really great to know about. I want to make sure I stay on my list of things. So that's one of the reasons I wanted to come and show this and just talk, because again, stroke is such a hard thing to recognize, even beyond fast. You know, there's no pain necessarily associated when someone is having a stroke. Sometimes, like, you sleep wrong, you're like, it's just because I slept wrong, or I sat wrong, or, you know, and any chance that I can get to show what you can do now, as well as really commend you guys, and such a great group. I don't know if you guys know this, you're one of the largest groups that anyone has ever heard of as a community support group. And we've been told that by several different people at different hospitals. And when we tell them when you guys meet and how often, and the great relationships that you guys have with each other, they're really kind of taken aback by how committed you guys are. And I just want to tell you that they know. A lot of people know. And I actually get several phone calls about people wanting to come, and then I tell them, and just they're really excited about this opportunity. And they keep, in the last week, well, I live over in the cities or something in my area. And the reality is you guys are one of the biggest and really robust groups. And I really think you guys should really know that and celebrate that. But you're here for each other. And I want to thank you for that, because it's so great on the nursing side to be able to tell patients, you know, we have something for you when you go home. Teary-eyed. Because, you know, stroke, as you guys all know, is something sudden. You're gardening one day, you're driving your car one day, and it's a sudden change. You know, it wasn't gradual. And so, you know, it's a very altering thing to have happen. And so to have a support group that can be there and have resources is really a beautiful thing. So thank you. One of the things I really wanted to tell you guys about as well, I'm sure Wanda has mentioned saving strokes. That golf event that's coming up, I believe it's April 29th. One of the things we wanted to do this year that's a little different, and if you can't come, that's okay, but I wanted to also let this group know is we're redoing our material at Huntington on stroke. And what I wanted to include this time is from the stroke survivor's point of view or caregiver point of view, saying, if you met a brand new stroke survivor today, what piece of wisdom, of encouragement, of what would you tell them? You know, I want to be able to say, you know, what I think, but I think it's more powerful coming from you guys. Of what would you want to tell someone that just had a stroke yesterday and has, you know, is worried about several things? I think having that connection is really important. So one of the things we're going to do at Saving Strokes is have everyone write those down, and I want to make a big type of my director and I are trying to figure out a way to make a big picture frame and make it meaningful, and also include it in our material that we give that stroke journal, that we can say, look, this is what patients are saying you need to know, and here's some encouragement and some quotes from your peers that understand what you're going through. Because sometimes because I haven't personally had a stroke, you know, it's hard sometimes to make that connection. I really want, I have family members that have, But you know, I think it's so much powerful coming from this group, and individually, what, and caregivers that are, you know, day in and day out taking, you know, that know, you know, sometimes, you know, one of the things that I've had people say is that they just wish they knew this. What is that thing that when you were, you know, when you were a patient, what would you have liked to have known? And so this is just something I want, so that I'm going to be collecting those on the Saving Stroke event. We're going to be looking for that. But if you can't come, that's fine. I can leave my email, or you can always call me and tell me, and I would love to quote you in that, because I think it's very powerful what you guys can share to the next person. Yes, Wanda. Okay, wonderful. Wonderful. I'm going to have something there. We will have the whole thing. You know how when we, I happen to have gone to the last two as a bedside nurse, you know how we have like a little blood pressure station? Sure. So I love the Saving Stroke event. It gives me an excuse to wear a visor, you know, and to wear a polo shirt. It's a great event where we celebrate rehabilitation of stroke through golf. And we have golf pros, and there's little stations set up. So you come and you check in. We partner with the American Heart Association. And there's lots of gifts and little handouts. And this year, there were some really good ideas on what to kind of give as a grab bag gift. I won't tell you what it is because I thought it was a great idea. Yes, it's got to be a surprise. But it's something helpful because we wanted it to be, again, something useful. There's lunch provided. It's, of course, healthy. As we, you know. It's a great lunch, and there's usually someone speaking. But the whole point is to go to these different stations and golf. It doesn't matter how good you are or not. Even some of the volunteers. So from Huntington, we have a lot of nurses and physical therapists and occupational therapists that come. And it's nice so that if you don't have to walk either. If you don't want to walk, they will take you via golf cart so that you're not, there's no stress on you. It's to really enjoy that rehab through golf and enjoy doing something that is actually quite relaxing. I can't tell my husband that I think golf is relaxing because then he'll make me go more often. But it is something nice. And last year, one of the nurses was helping somebody golf, and then she was golfing. And so it's a really it's a lovely day, lunch. And then during, right when you check in, we check your blood pressure. We kind of look at your risk factors just because it's something good to reevaluate and any questions you may have. So we actually have four nurses this year from the stroke unit that are going to come and work those tables. So within those tables, we'll have a little section where we want you to write what would you want to tell a new stroke survivor? What encouragement do you have? But I figure if I get your mind thinking now, you know, if you have a quote, some sort of Bible verse for those of you who you know, whatever it is that's really meaningful for you that you think would help, you can either bring that, or you just know that that's what I'm going to ask for, and you can write that if you know. And make sure you say your name, because I want to give you credit for passing on your wisdom to others. So we're trying to kind of make this more of a personal thing for everyone. So I'm really excited. So there definitely is going to be the table of kind of the different little knick-knack things, you know, the different things you can take home. Definitely like a blood pressure. And then after the blood pressure little station, we're trying to have what would be kind of like an encouragement station, I guess you can call it, where you would write down what kind of things you would tell a new stroke survivor or what things you would have liked to have known. And we're trying to do a surprise thing at the end of that, but you know, that's a surprise thing at the end. But another, along the same lines of encouragement. And no, it's okay. I don't mind. I don't mind. It is. That would be, yes. Thank you. Thank you for saying that, because I'm thinking stations, you're right. So I think like a massage envy or something like that was there. I think they're coming again, yeah. and the veggie people were there. Veggie people. So what it is that there's like a, they kind of deliver to your house. It's like a fresh produce, and you can pick and choose what you want. They were there. I think they're coming again. So I think there's another one, but I'm not totally sure. I was trying to figure that out. But I'm pretty sure both of those are coming back this year. They're kind of like a booth, if you will, if you're interested. Yeah. Exactly. And it's lovely. Every time I've ever gone, the weather's been nice. One time it looked like it was going to rain and it didn't, but it ended up being a really nice weather day. Sometimes it's really warm, but there, every station, just so you know, there's usually a tent. So if you want to sit under there, you can. And we, you can be charioted by the golf cart at any point. So it's a really fun day. I know from my own experience, the very first time I went to the stroke event, or the saving stroke event, what I found most valuable from my perspective was meeting the patients that I was able to take care of and see how they're doing. Because I go home at night wondering, you know, how'd they do? Are they getting better? Is there, you know, how's their family? And it's so rewarding to see the improvements and how much better that you guys become. And I think it's, I know it's really, it's a special time for me. And I know it's a special time for the nurses. So, and I'll let them know. Absolutely. Because I think so many times do we know you guys meet Harvey. So just to give you some, Harvey, a wonderful social worker, he normally checks in with us and kind of tells us what's going on. And I remember him mentioning when I was still, you know, a nurse at the bedside, mentioning, oh, if you guys ever want to come. And it, I didn't know what this group really was until I kind of talked with Wanda as well as Candy. So I think now that I know that, I think I can take that back and say, hey, it could be great for them to come down and say hi and to see how you guys are and any questions they can answer. Yeah, absolutely. And they all remember, too, because, well, we all have a, we know what room some of you guys were in. We know what room, we know what day, we know what, you know. And it's when you're at your most vulnerable, and we were there to help you. So we try our best to be like, I don't know you, because we're trying to be really, you know, respectful and make sure we don't say anything. So most of the time, if you see the nurses and they don't say anything, it's because they can't. If you say, you were my nurse, they would probably be like, oh, yeah, but they're not gonna off the bat tell you because they can't. So just know that. So it's not that they don't want to, it's that they can't. You need to kind of tell them, like, it's okay, remember me. So, you know, I think that's a great thing. Any questions?
I have ADM. Mm-hmm. And my record is 1980.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's where they went.
Yes.
Mine.
Yes, to fix it?
Yes. Well, yeah.
Did they coil or clip anything? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So, the AVM, they got rid of them. And I don't know what an AVM is.
Yeah. So, an AVM, so you have an artery and a vein, right? So it's when they're separate. So what can happen sometimes, for various reasons, the artery and the vein kind of get, they're too close, there's communication between the blood and the artery and the blood and the vein, and which shouldn't happen. So it kind of becomes, I like to do this because it's kind of, sometimes it looks like a ball. Like they shouldn't communicate, that blood shouldn't communicate to each other in that fashion. So there's some sort of opening between the two. There's various different sizes and types and that kind of thing, but that's kind of the easy way to explain it. And people that have what she's saying in AVM, what puts them, they're at risk for having the bleeding type of stroke. which is the one that you had, not the clock type. So, I mean, granted, you can have both, but in terms of the AVM, that's your risk of a bleed, because the vessels are fragile, if you will. But yes, that is a treatment that they do. They go in the groin. So what's interesting, to you make a good point. So for the bleeding type of stroke, they can go up depending on if they know the cause, right? And they've been going up there for years, either clipping it or coiling it, or what they can do for certain types of bleeds. And now we're also going up there for the clot types now and trying to pull out the clots. So it's the same point of entry. We're just trying to do more. For the most part, yeah. There's no real difference in terms of the testing. But again, every patient is unique. You know, they don't always do the same tests on someone who's in their early 30s versus someone who's in their 80s. But again, there may be more known. Sometimes, if you just had certain tests done yesterday, or everyone's different. But most of the time, it's pretty much the same standard for everybody. Okay. It's very similar, yeah. Yeah. And so, and over the years, you know, you said five times. Okay. Mm-hmm. And I think you could probably say that you could probably watch the treatment of stroke change completely, because that was before we had TPA for the clot types, and now we have this additional one for the clot retrieval. So I can only imagine in about 10 years where we're going to be at that point. Because with stroke, and you guys know this, I wish it were like heart attack, where it's so classic. And everyone knows, oh, you have a heart attack, we need to get you to the hospital, and that's just not what stroke is. And so, you know, getting that awareness is so hard. And you guys could recognize one easily, right? But, you know, most of the community struggle a lot. Or they, you know, you rationalize, oh, it's because you slept wrong. Maybe it's because I didn't sleep last night. So it's a harder one to get our hands around. But with these new procedures, we're able to do more. And so that it's not as, hopefully, debilitating as it once was. So it's something. Good question. It's a very good question. Well, hey, that's a good thing. That's a blessing. You don't want to remember that, right? Hey, that is something to know. Well, but I say, I've asked people's phone numbers and I get 6 digits. So, you know, if you know your phone number, that's half the battle. That's good. We can get a hold of somebody. Yeah. Wow.
anything new.
Oh,
you're so upbeat about it. Are you 2 years young? That's a really good way to put it. Actually, I'm saying the same thing, because when I threw out my back, and I was like, I should have known better, because, you know, when your parents tell you when you're younger, you know, don't live like that, don't do that. And you're like, I'm fine. Goes you in.
Oh! So we went into our doctor, primary care doctor, as well.
Oh my goodness! Well, I'm glad to hear that.
One of the nurses especially, she liked him so much that when it was time to get him to rehab, she had to transfer him, but she walked all the way
with him. I'm still walking into the second stage.
Yeah. Well, and, you know, because again, it depends on where you had the bleed, where what's right. Going on. Yeah. I know. It's hard to remember because where you have it, it's the opposite side. I'm so sad I never got to meet you. Well, and I have to say that the program has grown a lot in the last 2-3 years. One of the other things to let you know, one of my roles is to help train the ED nursing staff on stroke patients, and to help train ICU nurses, and to help train and partner with the stroke unit, so and rehab, and kind of make sure as a whole organization, what do we do for stroke? And so it's the same standard wherever you go here. And we work really hard to try to really, one of the things I love to do is I find that I follow every single code stroke patient. And I, whenever we could have an opportunity to maybe tweak the process so that we can be better, I do it. So that's the shortest way to say what I do, is to get it faster, get it more efficient, and get it consistent. And so that's why my job exists, which is great, so that we can have, because the sooner we get the clot out or the sooner we get the procedure that's needed, the better, right? Because time is brain, so you're trying to save as much as possible. Well, it depends. So this procedure, like if you've had one before, a stroke before, can you have this? Yes, you can. But again, it's case dependent. It depends on where you have the clot. It depends on some certain risk factors, of course. But that's the physician's decision, the interventional physician. I've seen there are cases that people have had prior strokes and they had this procedure and there wasn't an issue. Sometimes things that come into play are how long ago was that stroke, or maybe there's other underlying issues that we have to take into consideration. So it just depends, which is why it's so important when people get this procedure that physician has that conversation saying, this is what we're doing, this is why. So it's not like an exclusion, but it's definitely unique to each patient if they are or not. You can, but again, with certain criteria, like you have to meet certain criteria. It has to be in a certain, they say, large vessel, right? The clot has to be in a certain area. They have to see it. They have to be. There's kind of if you meet all those, there's not like they don't say you had a stroke last year. No, that's not what happens. They evaluate you on your current symptoms and what is currently wrong, where the current clot is, and how they can help you. That doesn't rule somebody out immediately. So yes, so the studies that they did when they did this procedure in the research setting is they score patients up. Basically, they were scoring patients on how were their activities of daily living, is what we call them, ADLs. How is it they were able to function after their stroke? And they were comparing patients that had this procedure against patients who did not. And the patients that had this procedure were able to have much more success at having better activities of daily living. So they had better outcomes. So they gained more of that quality of life skills, right? So some of them that some were able to have more function in their limbs or function in their speech, or they were better outcomes when you have this procedure versus not. And again, with a specific criteria, because you have to meet, you know, certain, it has to be in certain cases. I've seen, because I've been in a lot of the cases or watching. That's why I said, you know, sometimes right when they pull out that clot, what was once not moving is moving. So it's very quick change, because the whole point is we want to save that tissue in the brain, right? We want to get the blood supply back. But you, again, like anything, it's a tight time frame because there's a point of, you know, no return. So time is still of the essence of time. So the sooner we get to the clot, or the sooner we give something like TPA, the better, for sure. Does that help? I think it's pretty revolutionary. It's pretty great. You know, but it's, again, specific cases. So, and a lot that you can get TPA and this procedure. It's not, you can get both. Some patients get both because that's the nature of the need. So, it's not like just because you have TPA doesn't mean you can't have this. You can get both. So that, and some patients just get this clot removal because they can't have the TPA. So it's a really good tool. You can do them together. You can do them separate. It just, again, depends on their diagnosis and what the physician thinks is best, depending on certain criteria. Now that sounds very wordy, but... The FDA approved, yeah. Yeah. Well, the longer you wait, so the FDA says 3 hours, because the longer you wait, the more risk increases. So, like, let's say it is 5 hours, that if you did have a stroke, that tissue, you're at a higher risk for bleeding in your brain at that time. That's why they cap the time. So it increases the risk of bleeding. So that's why. pardon me. It has to do with the tissue in the brain, because it's not getting blood supply, so it's dying, if you will. And so the longer you wait, it's kind of like the whole reason why the longer you wait, the more likely it is that you're not going to reestablish blood flow. So the more damaged things become, right? So time, you're killing so many neurons per minute. I Dr. Constance, who's going to do this lecture, he's brilliant. He knows, like, how many cells you're losing every minute. And he absolutely is very passionate about stroke treatment. But it's all about that the tissue is dying. And so, like with anything, when they start to when something starts to deteriorate, you can't, if you give that medication, there's a higher risk. So it's all about the risk. And that's why the FDA put that 3-hour window, because the risk increases. Well, we don't. So it's a. It, but this is, we're talking about several hours outside of someone's stroke. You would be surprised how many neurons you lose in just 1 minute. It's a high number. Oh, please, yeah. Google. But this is all, just so you know, all of these devices and the medicine, it's all evidence-based. So what that means is they've done all the research, they've done all the evidence to say, okay, what is best? And they look at good outcomes of patients and the bad ones in research. And so the research says, you know, the best time frame, and that's why the FDA went with 3 hours, is last known well, when they were completely normal, to giving TPA is 3 hours. Because what they've seen beyond that. Does that make sense? So it's not like we're just arbitrarily picking something. It's based upon the research they've done over the years and what they've seen, you know, because they're always doing stroke research, especially a lot of the academic centers. We're a part of a lot of stroke research programs, but they are always looking at, you know, every year there's always like, do you expand the window? Do you not? Do you, like, so they continually question, just so you know, and they continue to look at that. Right now the evidence sits where it does. Now the American Heart does say, American Stroke, American Heart says 4.5 hours they're okay with, but that's their stance, which is different from the FDA, so it's a little different. But again, every year, you know, you reevaluate, you look at the evidence, what does it say, and it hasn't changed in a while. But again, there's always, they continually look at that to make sure that they're doing the best for every patient. So, that help kind of answer. Yeah. I mean, well, they do. So they do, but they don't. So like they do. What I mean is, I would. So in the research, sometimes they know. In research, sometimes there are cases that the last known will change to someone they gave TPA to. So they do research on these patients, and they know of kind of where they're at. It's kind of an unknown. It's kind of frustrating, I agree with you. So hopefully they're doing more research on that, exactly why, or they do, they're always trying to make different versions of TPA to see, is there something better? Is there a better medication that does it quicker or expands that window? There are things out there, it's just they don't ever make it to kind of the mass market because for various reasons, you know, clinical trials are very difficult and very regulated, which is good and safe. But which there's an obvious reason why it didn't come to market. So, because I have heard of different newer TPA type drugs, but for whatever reason, something didn't pan out. But you know, I'm not a researcher, so I don't. You know, sure. A year? We did these numbers last year because I do look at it as a whole. I would say 15%, roughly, but which is about, you know, that's kind of the national average, like 15 to 20, you know, ish, maybe even 10, but it's about 15%, I would say, that we have the bleed type of stroke. Because there's different risk, you know. Oh, a lot. There's some really great data on that. It's not always as current as I'd like it to be. Yeah. Well, and stroke really, you know, I believe it's the number one most disabling as well for, you know, when you're at home because of all those the residual effects. I can't word it right. I read it, but I can't word it right. There we go. Yes. So hopefully with these new treatments, though, that we can start, maybe we won't, that won't be number one for people. But, yeah. Any other questions I can answer? So this is the same, they're going in a little different. So this is pulling back down. So this is the same. And then this is when they, down here. So when they pull down and out.
This is the platform.
Yes. Yes.
Pull it down.
So yeah, this is like that finger trap thing. So they deploy it for about 5 minutes. And then they kind of pull it out. And through this, so they pull, so here you can see, they kind of like grab it and hold it onto it and pull it out as one package, right? It's a way to kind of think about it.
And what about the cells, if we do this procedure, what are the cells that the doctor said that die?
So, like, let's say they didn't get this clot out. Anything beyond here isn't getting blood flow, right? That's what's important. So the whole key is because there's something there that is not able, is not giving blood to the rest of that part of the brain. So the bigger that this vessel is, the more pronounced and more devastating some symptoms can be, because it's a big vessel. And it's, you know, because it branches off, right, into all these little vessels. So does that make more sense? Because if you're stopping the flow, and it's stopping right here. So if you can, yeah. And so it could go to a large portion of your brain. And so if you can open it up and reestablish that, then you can have gain function back, hopefully.
So, if after the stroke, a year after, you do this procedure,
how do we come? Well, so you can't, this is only for something acute, so a brand new blockage. Who is one of the ones that, yeah. Yes, acute, brand new, within so many, like it's a brand new clot, best way to say it. There's yeah. Ooh, what is it? Yep. Yep, it's an astronomical amount. Yeah. Yeah. If you can get in it from last, no, well, 30 minutes, the sooner the better, the sooner the better. Absolutely. Absolutely. I'm going to go have lunch first. Yeah, yeah. Oh, maybe it'll wake up. I'll give myself some time.
I just want to go to bed.
Exactly. You're right. Yep.
Exactly.
I've had numerous patients over the years that I've taken care of. They're like, well, I thought if I went to bed, it would just disappear, and it didn't. And, you know, I always like to say, better safe than sorry. Just call. Yes, be thankful for your stubborn wife. Oh, yeah, yeah. So elevated blood pressure, it depends on what type of stroke you're talking about. So if you're talking about a bleed type of stroke, some people that have like really high blood pressure or chronic hypertension that they don't have treated or under control, that puts them at a risk to have a bleed type of stroke, because you're having that high pressure for such a long time and it's not treated. So sometimes patients with like, and we're talking about really high blood pressure, that's uncontrolled and usually unknown, that's kind of what they're at risk for. That kind. When it comes to the clot type of stroke, oddly enough, if you're having an acute stroke and you just had symptoms and you're coming in, they actually kind of like high blood pressure, because it helps with perfusing the brain. It helps, you know, whatever, if you have any, wait, real technical, if you have any collateral. So if you have really good, the older you are, you kind of build some more networked vessels, right? To get your blood can go in different ways. Sometimes, does that kind of answer your question? I didn't think so. I was like, ugh. So high blood pressure, it depends on every patient. It depends on what type of stroke you have. It really does. Because again, everyone is different. If you have a history of high blood pressure and you have a history of diabetes and you have a history of high cholesterol, they're going to treat you a little bit differently than someone who came in brand new and they've never had a history of high blood pressure. So they really do a good job at individualizing this acute stroke treatment. And because we're talking about the acute phase, you know, the I'm having a stroke right now and I didn't have these symptoms just a while ago. When you're talking about having a stroke years ago, that's different. That you're talking about, you know, what it's different. That's something you need to follow up with your neurologist or your cardiologist. I wanted to ask. Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, just because you have high blood pressure doesn't mean you have a stroke. It's just, it's always wise to go talk to your general physician or your neurologist and talk about any time you change your meds or your medications. It should always be with a doctor, a doctor's advisement, and a doctor's, you need to really incorporate them into that, because they will be able to tell you what it's related to, what it's not, and why it's important. So I think it would be always best to go and talk to your primary care physician, or if you have a neurologist that you check up with every so often, them or them, to make sure that you're doing the best that you can to keep them under control. Because they know your body very, very well. I mean, even as a nurse, yes, I'm an advanced practice nurse, but I still go to my doctor. I still ask them questions. You know, they have a really good, they know what they're doing. They manage your medications very well, so it's really important that you tell them if you take a medicine or you don't, or if you stop taking something. It's really important. So, which actually, I think I'm in the process of trying to make fun medication cards that I would try to get for the Saving Strokes event that are going to fit in your wallet. So you can write not only what meds you're on, but you can also put like your little med history. So if you're ever, if you yourself just don't want to remember what you take, because nobody remembers, even myself, you can either pull that card out and it fits in your wallet, or you can, or if somebody, you know, heaven forbid you're found out anywhere, they can, you have something really easy and accessible. So I'm trying to make one that's to fold, you know, because I've seen the big paper ones, but nobody wants to fold a big piece of paper and shove it in their pocket. So I'm trying to get things to make useful for you guys when you go home. And if you guys ever have any ideas, things that you may need, or you can always let Wanda know or myself know, because I'm always up for trying new things of tools. Like the other day, I gave Wanda the Stroke Association has a really cool work kit. But we worked out the bugs and trying to how we can make it work for us and some pros and cons. So, any other questions? Yes. And it's nice if you set up the emergency thing if you have an iPhone. Nurses in the ER love it too, because they can press the emergency button if the phone's locked, and it'll tell them if you set it up who to call, what's your meds, what you're allergic to, some basic stuff. So if you have, I don't know, I know the Apple iPhones do it, obviously, but I don't know any, I'm assuming the other phones might have some similar feature, but they rely on that a lot. It's a great tool. You remember your phone number? Hey. Oh yeah. Yeah, and that exactly, which is what I was trying to make. What I'm trying to make is basically be that kind of. Why they decided to have two names for every medication? I don't know. Correct, I know. Something fancy. Yeah, we... Yep. I understand. Even as nurses, we have to memorize both names, and we all go, what? Wait, which one is that again? They shouldn't usually on the bottom of the generic form, but it's very tiny writing. So unless you have magnifying glass, you're not going to read it. Hey, but that safety first. Your pharmacist is a great resource in terms of, here's my plug for pharmacy. Always go to one pharmacist or one pharmacy location because that's the safest thing because they can really check all your meds, make sure they don't have interactions with each other, make sure they're all, there's no issues. When you start having multiple pharmacies, you start to have issues. So I always like to say one pharmacy. It's always wise.
The doctor said
oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Well, that's an interesting. Oh. I don't know how I feel about that. I don't know how I feel about that. Yeah, we are. We're very conservative, but in terms of a patient safety thing, I think that's wise. Yeah, it can be, yeah. Any other questions? I hope I was helpful. I hope I get to see you guys. Yes, Wanda. Sure. This is with Senior Care Network. And Roxy, did you say you work for Senior Care Network? Oh, see? So it's like the Stroke Awareness Day. It's May 4th, which I'm a Star Wars fan, so I love May 4th. May the 4th be with you. Anyone? No? All right. I think it's an excuse to wear Star Wars scrubs. So it'll be here in the Braun, which is here. So you know that if you go down the steps right here, that's the Braun on the left. So 11:30 to 12:30, there's like booths. I know I will be here, and we're good, again bringing a couple nurses, and we'll do blood pressures and things like that. There's other booths coming. I can really speak to the other ones. No, my understanding, what I'm told, I've never been, but my understanding is that they're all in Braun. But I could be wrong. This is what I am kind of being told. But what I do know is that there's like a lecture from 12:30 to 1:30, so it's an hour, and I believe it's Dr. Constance, who's our neuroradiologist, who does this procedure. He is fantastic, and he's very vibrant and really fun to listen to. You will not get bored. He just is a really good wealth of information, and he's a lot of fun. I always learn something new from him. So, Dr. Constance, K-O-N. Let me write it. I'm not very good. It's Greek. Greek. At least that's what I'm told. This is the current plan. So I think it'll be a great day because it's Star Wars Day. No, because it'll be really great. And I know Senior Care Network has a lot of other things incorporated. I don't think I tried to get a flyer for you guys, but I guess that's a good question. Let me look at my phone. I will tell you. It's a Wednesday. It's a Wednesday. How convenient is that? So Wednesday, so 11:30, 12:30, then 12:30, 1:30. So that's my understanding of when it is. There wasn't any flyers today. So worst case scenario, I might just have to make some flyers myself. So.
One other thing about that particular day, you can order lunch.
remember that you can have lunch in the Bronze Auditorium before the people come. And they have sodas and coffee and tea in the back.
Oh, that's great. You know, so is it just water?
They have water and coffee.
Gotta stay healthy, right? So I do have stroke prevention, stroke. I always say prevention, but it's stroke awareness. It's about stroke awareness. So, do I have a card?
I have just one of them.
They just redid our cards. New branding. So. I have flyers for those of you who don't have it, or brochures on this golf event that I will lead, if you guys would like them. They have our new logo, our hospital rebranded. Now we're fancy and green and blue. So I will leave them in the back. Anything else that I can answer or anything at all? Well, thank you so much for having me. I really, it's fun.
You're welcome.
You're welcome.